darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. And to reconcile the lost, to redeem the whole creation, you did not despise the cross. For even in your suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake, you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. The morning that you rose, all of heaven held its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who'd come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born. Then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel, true the Lord, shall not kneel and shall not fade. And by his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has risen. Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings, praise forever to the King.
Happy Advent. Second weekend of Advent, we prepare for Christ's coming, the celebration of Christmas. Seems to be a lot about Christmas trees and pine cones and red trucks and, well, Advent calendars, Advent wreaths, and so many celebrations that we include in our traditions for Christmas. God's blessing on you, grace to you, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. If you're in Northeast Ohio, really encourage you to come out on Sunday for worship services as we celebrate the second Sunday of Advent and the theme love. And then we're also looking at light and life and kind of looking at trees. What a surprise, eh? Looking at trees and Christmas trees and what God brings to us through, well, we'll see in just a few moments. If you're in Northeast Ohio, join us also for our Sunday School Christmas program, which is this Sunday at 4 o'clock. And it's such a delight as our kids come together, present the message of the gospel, the story of Christmas, and the excitement and joy that they bring, and also the fun and the songs, and also some good brass music. So we're so excited. We invite you to join us. Let's pray. Father, bless us as we read your word, as we study and look at your word, looking in anticipation to the coming of the Christ. We look at a number of different passages that highlight, prophesy, and talk about fulfillment of prophecy. And Father, we're so grateful for all you've done, for the amazing gift of Christ at Christmas. Thank you for the Advent season, which prepares us, and may we live in preparation and expectation. Thank you for the first coming of Christ, and then we look forward with great joy to the second coming of Christ. Bless us. Be with those who are sick, suffering, struggling. Father, may your hand be upon our people, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to look, first of all, at Luke chapter 2, verses 28 through 32. Luke chapter 2, 28 to 32. And the story, a little bit of the story of Simeon, who was a man of God who had the opportunity to meet Christ shortly after he was born in the temple. And he makes reference to prophecy, and he celebrates with a great, great song of celebration. This is Luke 28 through 32, that very interesting story of Jesus' mother and father and Jesus meeting this man, Simeon, in the temple. Simeon takes Jesus in his arms. He praises God, saying, "Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, this baby boy, Jesus, my salvation, your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people, Israel." So Simeon, in an encounter with God, had been given a promise that he would see this Christ before he died. And he's like, "I'm ready to die now. I've seen the Christ. Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you may now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people, Israel." The birth of Christ gives us life, gives us eternal life, gives us hope, gives us love, gives us peace. And so today we celebrate the gift of Christ as he brings us life and light and love. So I was thinking about this in terms of Christmas trees, because I love trees. I love evergreen trees. And in particular, blue spruce and Canaan fir, and of course, Norway spruce. And so we're thinking about Norway spruces because that's what we have planted all around the church property and are recommended by the local growers here in Lake County. And so we've been planting Norway spruces around the church, and we have some beautiful trees. And we were just joking, saying, "Well, we should be giving these away, like to the White House and stuff." And just then, Jan looks up Norway spruce on the internet, and there's a 62-foot Norway spruce. This was a couple weeks ago. 62-foot Norway spruce on its way to the White House or to the Capitol for Christmas, for the Christmas celebration. Beautiful trees. And what's it about? What is it about evergreen trees and Christmas trees? And what? Well, then I'm thinking about this, praying about this, and working this into a sermon. And this delightful lady from our church, Diane Mackey, most of you know her, comes in with this booklet. And it's, of all things, beginning, called The Christmas Code, beginning with a little stretch of stories about trees. And the first code word is roots, a Christmas gift. Then there's grief in the family tree of Jesus. Then there's grace in the family tree of Jesus. And something about trees, there is God in the family tree of Jesus. In this book, so much fun, talking about roots, asking the question about family trees, roots, and we celebrate Christmas with Christmas trees. And our family's always brought a live, real tree into the house for Christmas, and we love it. And we think that evergreen just highlights life, evergreen, eternal life. It points to the heavens. It has roots. And there's so much about that kind of thing in Scripture, including, well, the booklet begins with roots and family trees, seeds and roots and stumps, trees, life, light, love. Amazing. Always green, pointing to the heavens. Well, what about roots? First of all, I have this. This is, of course, a cone from a tree, which is right in our yard. And so grabbed it, thought, man, that's going to highlight something. And sure enough, it contains seeds. And so many things start with a seed. And we go all the way back to the book of Genesis, the seed of the woman. The seed of the woman shall crush her serpent's head. A prophecy, we believe, of the coming Christ, of Jesus, the Messiah, coming one day to go to the cross and through his life, his death, his resurrection, win the battle over darkness. And we love that. We love proclaiming that message. So we start with seeds and then roots. Listen to Matthew 1. Go to Matthew chapter 1, looking at roots or the genealogy of Christ. And we're fascinated by the study of our family trees. My cousin Carmen was like the expert, or is the expert in our family, on our family trees. But then we're thinking back to, oh man, grandparents. I could go back maybe to my great-grandparent, maybe remember his name. Anything beyond that? Nope, not so much. My great-grandfather was Jens. Maybe he was my grandfather. Maybe that's all the farther back I can go. A lot of us can't go back too far unless we've really studied the family tree. Listen to this, 44 generations in the genealogy of Jesus Christ. And I'm not going to read all of those because genealogies can get to be pretty boring. But listen, first of all, Matthew 1:1, this is the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Matthew 1:1, then Matthew 5, and the second half of Matthew 5 through the first half of 6. Obed, the father of Jesse, and Jesse, the father of King David. So just this, he's a son of David. This amazing proclamation about Christ, the son of King David. And then verse 16, and Jacob, the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary. And Mary was the mother of Jesus, who was called the Messiah. The amazing genealogy of Jesus Christ. And there's a list of three sections of 14 ancestors. Just an amazing story. And we celebrate that 42 generations from the time of Abraham, the father of the Israelites, to the time of Jesus, the Messiah. Amazing truth. Isaiah 11:1 and 10. So in the Old Testament, many prophecies about Christ come out of the book of Isaiah. Isaiah 11:1, a shoot will come up from the stump of Jesse. From his roots, a branch will bear forth fruit. So we got the seed out of here, leading to roots, leading to stumps and branches, all parts of a good old-fashioned evergreen tree, eh? And all of this is taking place in preparation for the life of Jesus. A shoot will come from the stump of Jesse. From his roots, a branch will bear forth fruit. The Spirit of the Lord will rest on him. And then to verse 10, in that day, the root of Jesse will stand as a banner for the people. The nations will rally to him, and his resting place will be glorious. And so we look at this, the family tree of Jesus, the roots of the Messiah, the celebration of the seed, the stump, the tree, the branches, the celebration of Jesus Christ, the Messiah, and of course of Christmas trees. The family tree in this little booklet, Grief and Grace, Matthew 1, again, 5b through 6. And listen to this as this works. So Obed was the father of Jesse, and we just read about Jesse and the stump of Jesse, the roots of Jesse. Jesse was the father of King David, and ultimately Jesus is called the son of David, the son of King David. David, though, was the father of Solomon, whose mother had been Uriah's wife. So the writer in the booklet highlights the grief that we see in Jesus' genealogy. David committed adultery with Bathsheba and killed Uriah, Bathsheba's husband, and eventually Solomon is born, who will become king, the wisest king of the universe, the world, and at least initially. And so we're seeing this, and it's part of the grief, but also a demonstration of God's grace. Troubled people in the genealogy of Christ, and we could list one after another in the genealogy. Troubled, but forgiven, people of faith, people God loves. And we see his great grief and grace. And an illustration of that, Luke 2:34-35. So to the third gospel, Luke chapter 2, verses 34 and 35. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother. So he's proclaimed the blessing about Jesus over Jesus. And then he blesses the family, says to Mary, mother of Jesus, this child, Jesus, is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too. And another prophecy, another looking toward the future, something will happen that will pierce the heart of Mary, the death of Jesus, the passion of Christ, but will bring salvation, but will bring hope as Jesus dies on the cross for the sin of the world. The family tree filled with grace, with grief and grace. Then, the Christmas tree. Again, roots, trees, stumps, branches, seeds. The Christmas tree, lights and life. And I think in our minds, Christmas trees symbolize light, life, and love. And we celebrate love and God's great love that he sends his son Jesus to be born into our presence, into our world. So I have a cartoon here from just a terrific cartoon. O evergreen tree, O evergreen tree, why dost thou rhyme with eternity? O Christmas tree, you bring delight and joy to me. Each year I place upon your breast the starry host which God has blessed. And shimmering lights reflect the cheer of memories from yesteryear. On ornaments that I revere, that touch my heart and bring a tear. You, Bethlehem, house of bread, where prophets said, he shall be born. Did host indeed the woman's seed, the bread of life upon this morn. In humble stable, wrapped in cloth, and laid inside a feeding trough. The Prince of Peace, who could foresee, came to us as a Christmas tree. Happy birthday, Jesus. And that's from The Wizard of Id, Johnny Hart, and his amazing cartoons. But just a fun picture of a man sitting under a tree and thinking about Christmas trees, but especially about Christ, his life, his death, and his passion. The Christmas tree, lights and life and love. Matthew 4:16. Matthew 4:16. The people living in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. And so we celebrate light in the Advent candles, in the Christmas tree lights, and in lights all around the community, the church, a season of light. The people living in darkness have seen a great light. A lot of folks that put out lights have no idea why, but it comes out of this message. In a time of darkness, this light comes, and those living in the land of the shadow of death, a light has dawned. To John 8, the fourth gospel, John 8, verse 12. And Jesus spoke again to the people and said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. And as believers, we are people of light. We absolutely believe that, preach and teach that. We are a people of light. 1 Peter 2, verse 9, almost to the end of the New Testament. 1 Peter 2:9. But you are a chosen people. And this is what God said. I love this. This is what God says about us as his people. You are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. So this amazing proclamation from Peter, out of 1 Peter, you are a chosen people, royal priesthood, called out of darkness into his wonderful light. And that happens because Christ comes to our earth, the light brought to the darkness. He lives a perfect life. People are upset with him. He's put on trial. He goes to the cross. He dies. And we teach that because he is God, is perfect, he dies for our sin as a sacrifice, as the Lamb of God. And so he goes to the cross. And what takes place on the cross? We celebrate, we go from the birth of Christ and the celebration of the evergreen tree to the cross, which we call a tree, which we call a tree. Galatians 3:13. And this is a pretty powerful passage, I believe. Galatians 6:13. Listen, Galatians 3:13. Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hung on a tree. Cursed is everyone who is hung on a tree. So Jesus dies on the tree. We call it the tree of Calvary. To Colossians 1:19 through 20. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in Christ, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven. How? By making peace through his blood shed on the cross, on the tree. To Romans 5, sixth book of the New Testament, Romans 5, 5 through 8. Hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. The heart of the theme of the first Sunday of Advent, hope, now moves into love and what God does for us through his love. God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. You see, just at just the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Very rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though for a good person, someone might possibly dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The cross, God's love, demonstrated fully in the cross, in Christ's death, to bring us to salvation, to bring us to justification. And we love that teaching, and we recognize that that is a part of Christmas. Christ comes to earth to live for us and to die for us, and then to be raised in triumph for us. Romans 5:8, the cross, the tree of Calvary. And then we close our message with a celebration of evergreen. And I think one of the reasons so many of us love evergreen trees is the fact that they're green all year long. And in an area like we live, it's nice to have at least a few things that are green all year long, right? There are a few other trees and bushes and the grass that stay green. But the evergreen tree among trees is pretty unique. And I have fun with my friend Johnny, who goes, well, you know, evergreen trees, why would anyone plant an evergreen tree? Like, at least, you know, hardwoods have acorns and some hardwoods have fruit and there's, you know, there's shade and that kind of value in a tree. But I'm going, yeah, but what about Christmas? And what about winter when it's cold and gray and dark? And it's just so neat to have the color of an evergreen tree. And so we celebrate the life of the evergreen tree. And they don't live forever, but they're green year round. And so they remind us of the gift of eternal life. And isn't that a great gift? Isn't eternal life a great gift? Go to Luke 1, 31 to 33. Jesus comes to bring us life, and not just life, but everlasting life, eternal life. Recognizing the nature of who we are as spiritual beings, we have an eternal spirit. We have promise of and the hope of eternal life because of Jesus Christ. Luke 1, 31 to 33. And this is another kind of proclamation of one of the people that was surrounding Jesus. The angel comes to Jesus and proclaims the birth of Christ. Mary's troubled by his words, and so he explains, you will conceive and give birth to a son. You are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end. An eternal kingdom. And we are given eternal life in this eternal kingdom. Amazing teaching, amazing truth. Revelation 22, 1 through 5. Revelation 22, 1 through 5. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb down the middle of the great street of the city. On each side of the river stood the tree of life, bearing 12 crops of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. And the leaves of the tree are the healing, for the healing of the nations. No longer will there be any curse. The throne of God and of the Lamb will be in the city, and his servants will serve him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. There will be no more night. They will not need the light of a lamp or the light of sun, for the Lord God will give them light. So we have the promise of God's love, light, and now this, life forever, and they will reign forever and ever. We're giving that amazing promise. And they, the people of God, will reign forever and ever. Eternal life in Jesus Christ. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes him should not perish, but have no experience everlasting life. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you.